أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم Another episode in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the beautiful surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, covenants between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the believers, calling them to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they do so, this is the means for their own salvation. Happiness in this life and in the hereafter depends on how people are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mankind to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. This is the purpose. And for them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, it's not a wishful thinking. It's not just something that is in their hearts, but rather it's something that they say and something that they do physically, and most importantly, matters of belief and actions that are present in the hearts. So it's all together. That's why the orders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers to do certain acts, to observe certain things, whether it's an act of worship or transactions or manners or dealing with others, whatever there is, this is all part of establishing the existence or the goal of our existence, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salvation is a big thing. Every single human being, they seek the salvation. For the believers, they seek their salvation in this life and in the hereafter, and the way to do so is again by being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, and we stopped at verse number 104, we'll take inshallah ta'ala 105 to 108. The first verse, which is 105, discuss one of the means to salvation for oneself and for the ummah in large, for the entire Muslims. There is means for their salvation as an entire nation, and also for an individual message here for every single Muslim. And the verse starts with the beautiful call, which is Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, and it's dealing with matters of enjoining good and forbidding evil. And it also shows there are some rulings that might be applied at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and also things that can be applied after the Prophet ﷺ, like the signs of the hour, for example. It might have not been established at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, but the Prophet ﷺ conveyed the message. For people to know the rulings and how to deal with it when whatever these signs comes. And this is also something that is mentioned in the verse that applies or implies such a matter. So we'll discuss that inshallah ta'ala, and also with regards to some of the rulings with regards to bequeath, the will before someone dies. This is will be from 106 to 108. So let's start first with verse number 105 in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ, which means, O you who have believed, upon you is responsibility for yourselves. Those who have gone astray will not harm you when you have been guided. To Allah is your return altogether. Then He will inform you of what you used to do. So this is a call, as many verses that we heard before and many verses to come in the Quran, that starts with Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And since every time we come across a verse that starts with Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, we should remind ourselves about this beautiful call. This is how our hearts should be purified when we reflect upon the verses of the Quran. We as Muslims were ordered to recite the Quran over and over again. Those who have the ability to recite the Quran, they never get satisfied when it comes to the goodness that are present. The more you recite the Quran, the more you want to recite more, unlike any other book. any other book because it's made by mankind. Once you recite it, once you read it, maybe once, twice, and you get bored of it. You don't want to read it again, over and over again. But when it comes to the Quran, this is the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more you read it, the more you reflect, the more you ponder, the more you want to read more. And every time you add more to your knowledge and to the matters of faith and iman and the beauty of this life. So this is basically the beauty of this Quran. That's why those who deprive themselves from the sweetness of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are really missing a lot on the face of earth. So as it's mentioned before, it's a call for everyone. If you have the ability to learn, learn how to recite the Quran, learn the language of the Quran, enjoy your life by being close and attached to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of these means of happiness and goodness is when you come across a verse that says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. So the believers are honored. Matters of belief is such an important thing. And it's a call that comes after it's either an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or something that we have been forbidden from. So we have to submit ourselves. So the person is ready. Once he hears Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, then the submission comes in place. The concern is to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. What is the rulings here? What are the things that we need to do? What are the things that we need to stay away from? So the knowledge is the goal. Once we know, then there's nothing but the submission to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is the order here, which is the means again to our salvation? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, alaykum anfusakum. Alaykum anfusakum. Anfusakum means yourself. Alaykum means be upon yourself, which means you're responsible for your own self. Upon you is responsibility for your own selves. You need to save yourself first. You will come in the day of judgment. You will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَكُلُّكُمْ أَتِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَرْدًا, as it's mentioned towards the end of Surat Maryam, which means every single person shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fardan, alone. We die, we become lonely in the grave. The only thing that we take with us, our deeds, actions. And when we are resurrected, everybody is alone, and everybody is seeking their own salvation till they enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they are believers, then they will be reunited with the loved ones. When people think about their loved ones in the face of earth, when you think about your loved one, you feel sad when you think of one day you will depart from them. You will have to miss them. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this life. But it's not about missing them or departing from them. It's about being, whether you're reunited in Jannah or to be departed forever and to curse one another when a person is among the people of the hellfire. So the concern is not to prevent this separation, because it has to happen. And this is what Jibreel alayhi salam, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ya Muhammad, ahbib man shi'ta fa'innaka mufariqu, which means love whoever you want to love, one day you'll depart from that individual. So it's not the concern, or there's no way for us to prevent it. It's something inevitable, something that has to happen. So the concern should be, how can we be then reunited in the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the everlasting joy. And that's why the concern should be the iman, the obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for oneself and also towards the loved ones, to the families, to invite them to be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on. But first the verse here says, alaykum anfusakum. Be concerned about yourself, save yourself from the hellfire. You're responsible first and foremost towards your own self. And therefore there's no compromisation whatsoever of your religion to save others, right, when it comes to matters of the deen. But then the verse says, لَا يَضُرُّكُم مَّن ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. This is what it means. It does not mean that you stay on your own self, don't worry about others, don't enjoy in good, don't forbid evil, don't invite others to the deen of Allah. This is not what it means. But rather it says, those who have gone astray will not harm you when you have been guided. لَا يَضُرُّكُم مَّن ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. Whoever is led astray, ضَل means led astray, he was deviated. لَا يَضُرُّكُم, which comes before it, which means he or she, they won't harm you. لَا يَضُرُّكُم مَّن ضَل. Those who deviated, they won't harm you by their deviation, but with the condition, إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ, if you are guided. So if you're guided, and the loved ones, those who are far away from you, those who you are enjoining good and forbidding evils towards them, those who you are inviting them to do what is good, they choose to be deviated, they're not listening to you, they won't harm you if you are guided. It is not your responsibility that they are guided. Your responsibility may be only in inviting them, conveying the message. But when it comes to guidance, the guidance of the hearts is only in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a beautiful verse that is giving the attention to oneself that you need to save yourself. You need to be guided. It gives us also the side here that whenever you are enjoining good and forbidding evil, whenever you're giving da'wah, calling others to the truth, you're more concerned about your own self, because this is the way for your own salvation. You're doing that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you to invite others, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you to enjoin good, to forbid evil. So it's a personal responsibility, because it's part of this religion. And also it shows that, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith, because some people, they misunderstood, or they might misunderstand the verse, as Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he sensed that some people misunderstood the verse and they thought that it means seclude yourself from others, be worry about your own self, don't worry about others, don't worry about the guidance of others, don't invite them, don't enjoin good and forbid evil. This is not what it means. So when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sensed that from the people, he said that some of you recite this verse opposite or not on the proper meaning of it. Then he ordered the people and showed them that enjoining good and forbidding evil is part of this religion. So not to be misunderstood, but rather to be understood in the proper way, that a time might come where a person, he sees that the people are not listening to what he's saying, that the person is inviting them to the truth, but rather they are following their desires. They're attached to the materialistic things of this world, and they're not willing to sacrifice anything of their joy in this life to choose what with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person sees this and he conveyed the message, then in that case maybe there is no point of inviting them anymore. And each situation is different, of course. And a person has to make sure that he is not compromising his religion whatsoever. Also, as the ulama, they say, when at times of fitan, tribulations, and people are against one another, and nobody is listening to anyone else, then stay on your own self. Stay with those who are close to you, your family, your friends, your immediate close people to you, and so on, and protect your religion. And don't waste your religion or waste yourself when things are not being conveyed in the proper way. So each, of course, people should seek the rulings from the people of knowledge. And it shows that things can change, or a person in a different situation, or a situation where he's not able to invite others or enjoying good and forbid evil, still have to hold fast to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. They won't harm you if they are deviated, but with the condition, إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ, if you are guided. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. To Allah is you return altogether. إِلَى اللَّهِ. See how this part of the verse starts with, to Allah. مَرْجِعُكُمْ, you all shall return. So to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. جَمِيعًا. Everyone. No exception whatsoever. Every single person, those who are guided and those who are misguided, those who used to invite others to the truth and those who would follow their desires and don't do it. So everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا, all of you. And what happens when everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. He will يُنَبِّئُكُمْ, he will inform of what you used to do. All of our actions, everything is recorded, and everybody will be informed of what they used to do, whether it's haqq, whether it's truth, or whether it's batil or falsehood. And the truth and the falsehood is mentioned clearly in the revelation from Allah. And when it comes to matters of knowledge, the matter is very clear. The disputed matters among people, whether people are deviated or not, everybody shall be informed in the day of judgment. If it wasn't sufficient for them in this life to see it, or to see the truth in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, or even in the matters that are valid for people to have differences of opinions, because the matter is not that clear in matters that are not core or principles in matters of the religion. Also, for those who deviated from the truth, they will see it. If they don't see it in this life, then relax, basically. Be comfortable in your heart that they will see it in the Day of Judgment. But then in the Day of Judgment, it's too late for them to take lesson, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's in this life. It's only benefiting in this life. So this is a beautiful verse that talk about the importance of guarding oneself, seeking the means of salvation to oneself, and conveying that to others without being affected by how people are led astray. Great benefit, great lessons. We'll talk about it more inshallah ta'ala, but more with the next set of verses right after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
لا يتدبرون القرآن
That group of category is one of the seven people who will be under the shade when there is no shade but Allah's shade on the Day of Judgment.
Colors of Arabic language, explain the word, the meaning of the word haya. They said it's the fear of something that's shameful.
At the same time you try to solve your problems, then you will see the results. And the advantage is sticking to the sunnah. When you stick to the sunnah, that's when you see the advantage. But could you elaborate more? What do you mean sticking to the sunnah?
It made a lot of major sense, because the problem is that they convince you, they try to convince you by saying Wallahi is the best, Wallahi it is the best, you won't find anything like it, So you're going from a sin to another sin, to a greater sin.
Man, it's been over 1 hour, I'm waiting for you.
Okay bro, it's not a big deal.
At least you should have called.
Oh, not again, don't get too serious.
عباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما.
So let's get inspired, let's get motivated to worship Allah in the best way. Let's get motivated not only to worship Allah in the best way, but to race to do good deeds. Join us in this program, Islamic Motivation, by your brother Rayyan Arab, exclusively on Huda TV.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome back, and with verses of Surah Al-Ma'idah from verse number 105-8. We talked already about verse 105 briefly. We'll come back to it inshallah ta'ala with lessons learned at the end. But now verse 106 to 108. It's talking about some of the rulings of al-wasiyyah or bequeth. And it's not the entire rulings of al-wasiyyah or the will or the bequeth, but some of it related to a specific situation that might happen to anyone. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this verse to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, calling again the believers, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. So we have two verses, one after the other, starts with Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe. Verse number 106, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا شَهَادَةُ بَيْنِكُمْ إِذَا حَضَرَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ حِينَ الْوَصِيَّةِ اثنان إِذَا وَعَدْلٍ مِّنْكُمْ أَوْ آخَرَانِ مِّنْ غَيْرِكُمْ إِنْ أَنْتُمْ ضَرَبْتُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَأَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةُ الْمَوْتِ تَحْبِسُونَهُمَا مِنْ بَعْدِ الصَّلَاةِ فَيُقْسِمَانِ بِاللَّهِ إِنْ ارْتَبْتُمْ لَا نَشْتَرِي بِهِ ثَمَنًا وَلَوْ كَانَ ذَا قُرْبَى وَلَا نَكْتُمُ شَهَادَةَ اللَّهِ إِنَّا إِذَا لَّمِنَ الْآثِمِينَ. Which means, O you who have believed, testimony should be taken among you when death approaches one of you at the time of bequest, that of two just men from among you or two others from outside, if you are traveling through the land and the disaster of death should strike you. Detain them after the prayer and let them both swear by Allah. If you doubt their testimony, saying, We would not exchange our oath for a price, even if he should be a near relative, and we would not withhold the testimony of Allah. Indeed, we would then be of the sinful. And more, continuing with the next verses, but let's take this one first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the believers, O you who believe, shahadatu baynikum. Shahada means testimony, the testimony that is between you. What is meant by this testimony is when death approaching, when a person is about to die, by the signs that shows this, a person is traveling, a person is, and he become extremely sick or on deathbed or whatever there is. حين الوصية اثنان, to have a bequest, to have a will, you should make sure that are two people are witnessing, and these people are trustworthy, or other than you, meaning other than you as Muslims, meaning even disbelievers. This verse has an incident that happened, or a reason why it was revealed at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, when a Muslim was traveling with two of the disbelievers that later they became Muslims, as Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu anhu and others. And they were traveling, and he fell sick, and he was about to die. So he wrote a will, and he put it in his clothes, and when he died, they took something from his belonging, something made of silver, or so something that is worth, you know, has a value to it. So they took it, they were disbelievers, they took it without the permission to do so. And then when he, the matter was related or returned to his family and they saw the will, or when these people, they saw the will and they returned everything, but they did not return that specific situation. And then when they saw this, and their family, they, when they looked for whatever his belonging, they said there's something missing. And then they found it with the disbelievers after they had took the oath that they have given everything that they that he had. But later, someone else from the relatives, they also bear witness that he something that belongs to him. So the verse had this incident where a disbeliever was made to take the testimony and witnessing over the will or the bequest of a Muslim. And this is basically the key to this verse. So basically the verse is saying, O you who believe, whenever it's time for one's death and a person wants to have a will or to write a will, whether it's verbally or written, to have two, اثنان, ذوى عدل منكم, two people that are trustworthy, people that would not lie with their testimony, which shows the importance of having to testify with justice, with truthfulness, and not to lie whatsoever. From among you, meaning from among the Muslims, minkum, from Muslims, which shows originally the rulings is that the Muslims are the ones to give the testimony and not the disbelievers. Unless it's a necessity, which is the case in this situation, there's no more Muslims around, or a person is traveling and there are no Muslims, or a person living in a land where there are no Muslims. And can he then, in this case, you know, make disbelievers testify when, or be witnesses over his bequest? Then it's permissible. أو أخراني من غيركم. And this is what it means, without going into the details or the differences of opinions, because some of the ulama, they said this is something that has been abrogated. The ruling have been mansukh, meaning abrogated, but the correct opinion that it's not been abrogated. أو أخراني من غيركم, or other than you, meaning from the disbelievers. إن أنتم ضربتم في الأرض فأصابتكم مصيبة الموت. If you were traveling on the land, فأصابتكم مصيبة الموت, the calamity or the disaster of death befalls upon you. So you are in a situation where there are no Muslims, there's no relatives with you, you're traveling, and it happened that everybody around you are disbelievers, and you need to have a will right there, so there's no harm if the disbelievers are witnessing over the bequest or the will that you have. What to do with them? تَحْبِسُونَهُمَا مِنْ بَعْدِ الصَّلَاةِ. You keep them till after the salah. What salah? Many of the ulama, they say salatul asr, asr salah, or any salah. And the significance of that is that after salah, people are more likely to be more honest. They just finished their ibadah, their act of worship, and specifically, of course, for the believers. So for them to testify and to swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they are honest and truthful of what with regards to the belonging of the deceased. تَحْبِسُونَهُمَا مِنْ بَعْدِ الصَّلَاةِ فَيُقْسِمَانِ بِاللَّهِ. They would have to take the oath, swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إن ارتبتم لا نشتري به ثمنا ولو كان ذا قربة. They would swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they would never lie, they would never exchange their oath for a price, they would never change their testimony for money that is given to them, for example, or if a person is relative or related or not, they are going to be truthful no matter what. And that's basically what the testimony is. A person, if he's called to testify, even if it's against oneself or against one's father, one's mother, one's children, then he has to say the truth, the absolute truth, without ambiguity whatsoever, without saying things that might mean more than one thing, hiding testimony when a person is in front of a judge or so, even if it's against the most closest or the closest relative to oneself. This is something that is a major, major sin. So making sure that they would say the truth and they would never exchange their testimony or give false testimony for money or because of a relative or so. وَلَا نَكْتُمُ شَهَادَةَ اللَّهِ. And we won't conceal the witness and the testifying to the truth, because it's شهادة الله, that means to testify that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is witnessing them, that He is all-seer subhanahu wa ta'ala and He knows what they're saying. إِنَّ إِذَا لَمِنَ الْآثِمِينَ. That they would say that indeed we would then be of the sinful if they would say anything other than the absolute truth when it comes to testifying after with regards to a will or a bequest. Then what happened if the testimony of these disbelievers or even the Muslims with regards to someone's bequest, signs or some evidence showed that they were lying in their testification, then what the ruling or what should be done then? This is what the next verse says, which is 107. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْ عُثِرَ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُمَ اسْتَحَقَّ إِثْمًا فَآخَرَانِ يَقُومَانِ مَقَامَهُمَا مِنَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَحَقَّ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَوْلَيَانِ فَيُقْسِمَانِ بِاللَّهِ لَشَهَادَتُنَا أَحَقُّ مِنْ شَهَادَتِهِمَا وَمَا اعْتَدَيْنَا إِنَّا إِذًا لَمِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Which means, but if it is found that those two were guilty of perjury, let two others stand in their place who are foremost in claim from those who have a lawful right, and let them swear by Allah, our testimony is truer than their testimony, and we have not transgressed. Indeed, we would then be of the wrongdoers. Here the verse is saying that after the first two, they testified that whatever the bequest was of the deceased was such and such, and they said the truth, or they claimed to say the truth. But if the matter is, they found out that their testimony was false, it was not the truth. So then what should be done? فَآخَرَانِ يَقُومَانِ مَقَوْمَهُمَا. Then other two, other than them, would take their place, whether they are from the relatives of the deceased or those who have more knowledge about the matter. Then these two others will take their place, and they would swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that their testimony is correct, is the truth, and not like the previous ones. وَمَا اعْتَدَيْنَا, and we did not transgress, otherwise we'll be among the wrongdoers. You know, many things are based on testimony, and this is something in the legality of things, when in the rulings of this life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best and knows exactly who's wrong and who's right and who deserves what. But when it comes to the life of the people, that's why there has to be laws, there has to be judges and so on. A person is killed, for example. In this case, a person died and he had a will, he had a bequest, before he died. And those who were present were only two people. And these people might be trustworthy, or they might be liars and not trustworthy. So what to do in this case, if they would testify and they would swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's not been challenged by anyone else, then the matter has to be done this way, and this is according to the capacity of the human beings. But if there are signs or evidences showed that they were lying or they were not saying the truth, then two other than them, as in the case of the story that happened at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the relatives of the deceased, they realized that there is something missing, and they found it with those who testified. So there are more evidences here that showed that those who testified, they took wrongfully something that belongs to the deceased, in which they should have submitted it to the relatives and so. So when they saw that with them, and then these two at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they claimed that this was a price given to them for something that they gave the deceased. And later on, when Adi ibn Hatim radiallahu anhu, he became a Muslim, he said to the Prophet ﷺ that the testimony was false. So two other than them would testify because of evidences showed, and they would say that their testimony is more correct, and they would not transgress, otherwise they become from the zalimeen, from those who transgress, from the wrongdoers, from those who commit injustices and so on. And then the last verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying how that this is basically the most perfect way to protect one's right and one's bequest after someone dies in a situation like what we heard in the verse, as it says in verse number 108, ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِالشَّهَادَةِ عَلَى وَجْهِهَا أَوْ يَخَافُوا أَنْ تُرَدَّ أَيْمَانٌ بَعْدَ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاسْمَعُوا وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Which means that is more likely that they will give testimony according to its true objective, or at least they would fear that other oaths might be taken after their oaths, and fear Allah and listen, and Allah does not guide the defiantly disobedient people. So this is the most perfect way, specifically that, or especially when people are not trustworthy, or something showed of a sign that they were not saying the absolute truth. So that's why the ruling comes where two others will testify to oppose the first testimony. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِشَهَادَةٍ. This is basically what's more likely, that they would give the testimony in the right way. Why? Because they would fear that their testimony will be rejected, their oath will be rejected, so they will be exposed to others, they will be exposed to be liars, and they might be even responsible for lying, for example, in front of a judge or so, as we know that if someone would give a false testimony, this is something that is punishable in this life, and of course, in the hereafter. So they would fear this when they know the ruling, that if they don't say the truth and something comes up, or an evidence that comes up, then their testimony will be rejected. So this is more likely that they would say the truth from the first place, in the first place, so that they would protect their honor and dignity, and they would say the truth. And basically the truth is what needs to be there, especially with rights and money and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding the believers, since the verse starts with Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَيُّهُ who believe, it says وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاسْمَعُوا. Fear Allah, be dutiful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and listen to the truth and follow the truth. Get to know the rulings, get to know what is right and what is wrong, and don't be disobedient. Don't turn away from the truth. Don't follow your own desires when it comes to situations like this, but rather follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you. Wallahu la yahdi al-qawm al-fasiqeen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not guide the fasiqeen, those who are defiant and they are disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not guide them. It means that yes, a person might be disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, might be a disbeliever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide him, and this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for him to be guided. But for those who die in the state of disbelief, those who die in the state of fisq and disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they died in that state, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not will guidance from them. And it shows that guidance, a person can be prevented from guidance if he is defiant, disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doesn't want to take the means of guidance. So you know that some rulings here and some situations that might arise and so on, but we'll talk about the benefits and some of these rulings after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
لا يتدبرون القرآن.
From that, I've really come to understand that to be a Muslim, to be someone who says they've surrendered and submitted to the will of God, is to be in harmony with everything around you and to be a benefit to everyone.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Creator, He gave us a life plan. He told us what to do. He gave us, goals and what He expects from us.
It has roots in Islam because the first man who was created, Adam, he was neither a Jew or a Christian, but he submitted himself to God. Abraham, he didn't submit to anyone in creation. He didn't even hear in any of these religions. But when he was told to do what? Submit to the will of God. That's Islam.
Attached to his preconceived notions.
Yes.
And if he looks with an objective eye and an open heart, he'll see it. Unless Allah, for some reason, has something over his eyes because of something that we don't know is in his heart.
You had, from 1980 to 2005, you had the FBI data report showing that, now from all these years, that only 6% had any links to Islam. 94% were people who had nothing to do with Islam.
This is the Deen Show.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Verses 105 to 108 in Surah Al-Ma'idah. We briefly talked about the verses, rulings with regards to protecting oneself and means to salvation to oneself when it comes to seeing things are different and people are not listening to the message that is being conveyed, and also some of the rulings with regards to bequeath, where people might be in a situation where they have to take the testimony of those who are not trustworthy or the testimony of the disbelievers, and how to protect the truth in this case, and how they will understand that their testimony can be rejected if they would speak what is lie, if other evidences comes out, and to make sure that they would say the truth and the rights of those who are living after one's dead is protected, which shows the importance of this is part of the religion, part of the covenant with al-uqood, which is mentioned in the beginning of the surah, the covenants between people, something to be really respected and to be honored in any dealing with people. With every single penny, a person has to be careful that the matter is done according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. So we learn from these verses, as we heard in verse number 105, that save yourself first. We can apply this in many of our situations in our life. Many people, they might compromise their religion out of shyness towards others. They don't want to maybe break the hearts of others, their friends or their relatives, or even their mother and their father. They're invited to a situation or environment which is sinful. And if they refuse, say for example a wedding, one's brother's wedding for example, and this wedding has haram in it, things that are not permissible, and a person is not permissible for him to be present in such an environment, but if he refuses and if he says I'm not going to attend your wedding, then this can break the heart of his brother for example and make them upset and sad and so on. So many people, they would compromise their religion out of shyness towards others, or maybe pressure from others, peer pressure, whatever there is. So this verse comes in place that be concerned about your own self first. Save yourself. You will be asked about your own self. If you invite them to the truth, if you tell them that this is not permissible and they refuse to listen to you, they won't harm you as long as you are guided. We also learn from the verse that enjoining good and forbidding evil is one of the ways of salvation to the entire ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that in more than one hadith, which shows that when people stop enjoining good and forbidding evil, when people are enclosed towards their own self and they don't want to convey the truth to others, they don't want to advise others, then this is all means of destruction to any nation. Why? Because sins will be widespread. It will spread more and more. But when those who are righteous, when the believers, when the people of knowledge, they take that responsibility of educating others, being strong on the truth, telling the people that this is permissible, this is not permissible, whether it's in the khutbah of Jumu'ah, whether it's a personal advice, to keep the religion alive among the people. Nations before, their religion has changed or the message has changed because those who are responsible, the people of knowledge among them, they betrayed the message. They did not convey the message, they concealed the truth, or they altered the truth to please others or rulers or others or friends or whatever there is. And others, as a result of that, things change, and that's why one messenger after the other has been sent. The Prophet ﷺ is the final messenger. And that's why the responsibility on this ummah, upon this ummah, especially the ulama, the people of knowledge of this ummah, is a great responsibility. No more messenger to come. So then within the ummah itself, they have to be holding fast to the truth and conveying the truth and being patient when people are rejecting what they're saying, when people are not able or willing to listen, they're following their desires and so on. People still have to be firm on the truth and convey it. And the most important thing is to protect oneself and one's religion so that a person is not falling into matters of deviation and being led astray. And what comfort the hearts of the believers and the people of knowledge and so on is that everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The truth that you're conveying might not be heard of in the time that you're living. People are not listening to you, but eventually they would see it, whether it's in this life or in the hereafter. And we can see that clearly when you know, for example, when you're raising your child and your child is doing something that is can bring harm to himself, and you would say to the child, no, you have to do it this way, and you know for sure, certainty, that this is what is good for him. A child, for example, doesn't want to study for his exam, and you know that if he doesn't study, he would fail, and if he fails, this can make his life more difficult and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But if you leave the child to do whatever he wants, right, he would be angry with you later after he grew up, and he would say, my parents didn't raise me right, my parents didn't make sure that I would study my, you know, my school and so on. Although when he refused and you accepted and you followed his will, maybe he was happy with you when he was a child, but when he grew up, he will be against you. He might even curse his own parents. So why? Because you know with certainty what's coming ahead. The same thing when the believers, they know what's coming ahead in the day of judgment, at the moment of death. People would wish then, when it's too late, that these believers have, you know, dragged them to see the truth and forced them to see the truth. Of course, this is not something permissible in this life to be done, but that shows the importance of making sure that the truth is being conveyed without having the fear of being ridiculed or mocked at or whatever there is, but to hold fast to the truth and convey the truth, and knowing that everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, the important lesson: when there is fitna, when there's tribulations, when people are not listening to one another, and you already convey the truth and people are not listening, then take yourself away. Be concerned about your own self. And this is one of the etiquettes, one of the rulings to be observed. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he forbade us from arguing with the people of bid'ah innovations. You convey the truth and that's it. If they don't accept it, you stay away. But arguments going back and forth, and everybody's trying to be victorious with his own opinions and so on, no, stay away from this. The truth does not need to be disputed. It's revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The great benefits also that we learned from the other set of verses that talks about rulings of bequeath is that in a situation, and that's why it shows the comprehensiveness of the deen of al-Islam, that nothing is being left till the day of judgment for people to conduct their life in the most perfect way. We know the importance of the bequeath or the will, and the Prophet ﷺ made it very clear that if you have rights that you need to give to others or so, do not sleep at night unless you have a will. That you have a will. Maybe someone you know, owes you money, or you owe someone money, or whatever there is, write your will, whether you are before traveling or before Hajj or at any time, so that the rights are not being wasted. Because people, after someone dies and someone shows up and he said, you know, he owed me some money, where's the evidence? What's the truth about it? And if there's no evidence, then they cannot do anything about it. And then the person in his grave will be responsible for it, even though the debtor or so, they did not have the proof to show. So that's why it's important to have a living will. And especially for those who live among non-Muslims, and the rules of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is not being enforced or applied, then they have to make sure that their bequeath is very clear when it comes to rules of inheritance. We know in many parts of the world, when someone dies, all the wealth maybe goes to his wife or goes to authorities, whatever there is. A person knowing that this might happen, he has to have a will, that he has to write in it all the rules of inheritance, or he has to refer to an Islamic center or an institutions or something, so that rights are not being wasted. So this is a very important thing, and it has its own rulings, and it's important that everybody whether to have the knowledge of it, to ask the people of knowledge, but you have to have a will, you have to make sure that your wealth is being given to the proper individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the situation, the specific situation that we heard in the verse, that even if you have to ask a disbeliever to testify, then this is something that is permissible. And we see that even in hospitals, for example, when a person is in the hospital and he's a Muslim and everybody else are disbelievers, then they would be testifying for whatever, a will or signing something, whatever. This is absolutely fine. There's permissibility in this, and the verse is an evidence to that. And also it shows how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protecting the rights of the believers to make sure that the testimony is done in the most proper way, is that if it's challenged by other evidences, then other people can testify. So the original ones would fear for their honor and dignity to be accused, and that's why they would say what is the truth. Of course, it shows also the importance of testifying with the truth and to be on the truth and not to be ambiguous when it comes to testimonies. And otherwise a person is a sinner, otherwise a person is committing injustice. And even though if the judge would give the rulings for your favor, it doesn't mean that the person is saved from the punishment in the hereafter. And it's not according to the rules of this life, but rather according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. And that's why the importance of everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the significance in the verse 105, إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ, that everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he would inform you of what you used to do, also with regards to matters of bequest, that in matters of bequest, that things, everybody shall return to Allah. If you hide anything, if you don't give the truth in your testimony, everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many people on the face of earth, they were wrongfully accused? There are even many people that have been given death penalty, and it's not justified because of a false testimony. Almost everyone even know at least a case or more, which shows that the real justice is not going to be served in this life. Because some people are evil, some people are liars, some people that are so corrupt that they would rather, waste the life of others to make sure that they would gain some money or gain some fame or whatever there is. So the ultimate justice is going to be served in the Day of Judgment. And that's why there is Day of Judgment. This is one of the wisdom of having the Day of Judgment, because everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and everybody will be informed. And in the Day of Judgment, there is no money, there is no dollars, but rather it's one's good deeds versus one's bad deeds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's part of the existence of ourselves on the face of earth, is to establish these means and to be just and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to rule according to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to protect the rights and the wealth of others, as this is part of our religion. So again, as we see, the verses are all means of salvation, are means of happiness in this life and in the hereafter, if people follow the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more verses towards the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah next time. So till next time, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you all. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
لا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
فلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا